Yes, hello again. Welcome to the first round ball rules of the new season. Christmas comes but once a year. But let's be honest, the start of the football season is much more exciting. Joining me on the couch to look ahead to the new Isuzu UTE A-League men's campaign, we have got the Aussie wonder from down under, Daniel McBreen.
Thanks,
that
Simon.
Used to be his name when he was doing the fighting. And the lyrical gangster, Andy Harper. Good to see you guys. How are you?
Good. What's your name?
Simon Hill.
Ponytail Express.
I'll cop that. Good to see you guys. Excited about the new season?
Well, yeah. Always. Who
yeah.
isn't?
Yeah.
I mean, it's a long, long off-season, and even if it wasn't, you'd still look forward to a new one, so I can't wait, for sure.
Absolutely. Before we get into the A-League preview, and we'll go through all the 12 clubs and get their prospects, or at least the thoughts of the two guys on the club's prospects, but we are going to briefly look back at the Australia Cup final, which, of course, took place on Saturday at CommBank Stadium in Parramatta. Macarthur winning their first ever piece of silverware. It was a great crowd, 16,000 people there, Macca. And the Bulls serving notice that they're going to be a force to be reckoned with in this A-League season as well.
Well, yeah, Dwight York seems to have got them all on the same path and believing in themselves, and they just demolished teams along the way, didn't they? I think it was 19 goals for, 2 against, and, you know, Sydney United did a very good job to get where they did. They held themselves in great account on the night as well, and it took 2 penalties to break the deadlock. But it was a wonderful spectacle overall on the main. And Macarthur, like you say, they look good going forward to the season start.
Harps, that front four of Macarthur, you're particularly excited by it.
Well, who isn't? I mean, Davila and a huge, I mean, the way the team and the club rallied around Uli Davila, given the horrible personal tragedy he's still having to deal with, and football this season and beyond, but certainly this season with the acuteness of it all, the loss of his wife is just going to be such a treasured source of refuge. I think the club actually might be able to, if I use the word extract, it sounds like I'm trying to exploit a really negative situation. But I really think it can galvanise this team who love Uli. We love him as fans of the game. They love him as a teammate. The only context on the match, I'd say, and as good as Macarthur have been, was the fact of the matter is they only had to knock off one A-League men's opponent on the way through. So quite what sort of filter that provides to their ultimate success, I don't know. I would say to Sydney United, though, fantastic on-field performance, and I'm still wondering how Adrian Vastalitsa and Matty Bilic have avoided A-League contracts. I think they were both fantastic through the tournament, and particularly in the final. Huge performances.
Maybe they won't going forward. Now, it would be remiss of us not to touch upon the events off-field, which have made such negative, sadly, headlines in the media over the last couple of days. What needs to be done about this, Harps, in your opinion?
Well, the game has to be strong. And Football Australia, to their credit, have been strong in denouncing whatever took place. And completely unacceptable. Difficult for people at the time, particularly those not conversant with a language other than English, what might have been going down. And but as it's unfolded, just horribly, horribly unsavoury, unacceptable behaviour. Action's got to be strong. It's limited to isolated individuals, I believe. And so on that basis, Macca, it shouldn't be that hard to make the stand that's required.
No, and they're working with the police and security to try and nut those people out. They did eject people from the ground, but there's no place for that in our game or our society in general. So hopefully that gets dealt with, and we can all start talking about the positive side of our sport again.
Okay, let's talk about the positive side of our sport as we look ahead to season 18 of the A-League men's competition. We're going to go through all the clubs one by one, and we're going to start, guys, with the champions, Western United. Perhaps surprise winners last year, Macca. History tells us that it's very, very difficult to go back-to-back in the A-League. Only Brisbane Roar and Sydney have ever done it in the league's 18-year or 17-year history. Do Western United have a chance, do you think?
I think they do. If you look through the squads, the ins and outs of all the squads, they're probably the most unchanged squad of the lot. And we all know that consistency is really conducive to performances over the long term. So the fact that they haven't had a huge turnover of players in and out like some of the other squads, they all know each other well, they're all well drilled on that. I think they can come into that season Okay, last year they sort of crept up, didn't they? But I think this year they'll have a little bit of a target on their back, obviously. Mm. But whether or not they can take that and drive with it and run with that and say, well, come and get us, that'll be the question.
I don't know that there's quite been enough activity. So Western United have got some major plans that they're still trying to bring to fruition vis-a-vis the stadium issue. That occupies a lot of the thinking, and the football operation is run by Johnny Aloisi and done very well. What a great job. And so what I'm about to say, I know John Aloisi is going to print out and put around the dressing rooms to say, look, we'll shove that right up his, you know, by the end of the season. So they're certainly capable, and every defending champion comes in not only with the target on their back, but also still with the glow of last season. And no one ever expects the champions to fall. It does happen from time to time. Newcastle famously went from first to last in the space of an off-season. So it can happen. I'm not expecting that. So Johnny, you know, don't get too angry with your team talks, but. You know, they've lost Rene Kiahan. We didn't see a lot of him last year, but I saw enough to realise how influential he can be. And I've got to say, I've got big question marks about Prijovic. There was a lot of talk about their number one striker not coming back to the league in the off-season. The degree to which he effectively reintegrates, I don't know if there's anything right or wrong, but I'm just looking as an outsider, as a guy who is being talked about not coming back and then he's back. So how does Johnny manage that? He's certainly good enough to do it. I'm talking the coach. They've got a great coaching staff. I just don't know if they've refreshed enough, Macca. We'll see.
OK. I think the interesting signing for me is James Troisi. Obviously, he's 33 years of age now, but there's no doubting his quality. And, excuse me, will he provide that creativity in the absence, at least in the early part of the season, of Alessandro Diamante? And what sort of role does Diamante play once he gets his full fitness back? That, of course, is for John Aloisi to decide. And watch out for Tongo Dumbia as well. I know John Aloisi's got big raps on him. Let's move on to Melbourne City, last year's beaten grand finalists. Again, they look very strong. They've strengthened their squad. They've brought in a few from overseas. Richard van der Ven, Thomas Lamb. Connor Metcalf has gone the other way, of course, to Sampaoli. Mm. What do you make of City's prospects?
Well, you know, I think the World Cup, bizarrely, is going to have a big say on the season, Macca, for Melbourne City. You know, they have brought in a couple, but, you know, Melbourne City is not a club of big turnover year on year. There's a lot of stability. You talk about Western United stability. I think Melbourne City has been the byword for stability. They've backed coaches that haven't particularly worked, but they've moved them on when it's their time, not everyone and the hoarding masses calling for it. Same with the playing squad. But I bring the World Cup into the discussion because it has the potential to affect Tilio, McLaren and Lecky, three big players. Not that Tilio's been a rusted-on starter. But I just think this looms, and I'm thinking in a very positive sense. You know, if those three guys get called up to national team duty, all three, probably two of them, have a great World Cup and come back full of international beans and let loose on the league, I can see Melbourne City again being really, really tough to shake.
I saw shades. We spoke of Sydney FC after having so much success over so many years with not much turnover, similar players. We talked there about stability being great. I looked at Melbourne City last year and I think they fell away a little bit during the season in spite of that, because they had the same players. And it was like, is it a little bit of staleness coming? Do they need to freshen up? And have they done that well enough? I'm not sure. I think they'll still be up there and thereabouts because they've got good depth in across the board. But I'm not sure if they can be at the top of the pile when the season finishes.
That's interesting because Jenkinson's moved. And he was great for him. He played every game. So there was part of your stability and not required, comes back to the Jets. Roston Griffiths was outstanding for them and so adaptable in different positions. And of course, he was part of that staleness, I guess, is the word you're talking about, just notwithstanding the quality of his performances. So his move, they're two big holes to fill. And they've never been really that aggressive in the transfer market, I think, much to the chagrin of their fans. You know, I think their fans, if I may presume to say, would be hoping for bigger splashes in the transfer pond from time to time. But the proof's been in the pudding so far. Maybe you're seeing what might happen. They might be a bit stale, Macca. I don't know. I'll believe it when I see it.
I think the one positive for Paddy Cisnorbo is the fact that Aidan O'Neill is back fully fit this season. Of course, he missed the finals campaign last year. He's one of those players, isn't he, that you don't notice until he's not actually there.
But as you've said, Metcalf's gone too.
Yes, true. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So interesting season ahead for Melbourne City. What about their big rivals, Melbourne Victory? And, of course, their headline signing, Macca, who is Nani, he's going to be the big marquee name across the competition this season. And I guess the big question for him is can he do for Tony Popovic what Shinji Ono did for Popper at the Wanderers many years ago? He's certainly got the ability, we know that.
Yeah, look, everyone across the league wants him to do well because it will shine a light on our league again. He, you know, the big names of Dwight York and Nanny coming in, he undoubtedly has the quality, the ability to light up the league. It's whether he settles in well with his teammates in the new environment and Australian way of life, I guess. But I guess time will tell with him. I think he'll score regular goals. That's how well does he work with those people around him and use all that experience to help them come along on that ride and bring them to the next level.
Mm. Oh, great pickup. What we saw, and it's not just because of his reputation, what we saw in the Cup match against Western United, he already came on wanting to dictate the flow of things. And, you know, the sort of experience and quality he brings to the likes of a Jake Bremer. I mean, how exciting a prospect is Jake Bremer, speaking about World Cups? I know he's only got a few games to get ready, but if he's not this World Cup cycle, he's definitely next, Jake, from what I've seen. Mm-hmm. So you have Nani sort of grooming that that sort of talent. And I'm expecting massive things from Melbourne Victory, on and off the field. I think the club has just been a behemoth in A-League men's terms forever. A lot of the league, really, let's face it, has relied in the numbers that Melbourne Victory has been able to generate, members-wise, attendances, etc., etc. But I'm expecting that huge organisation to change course even more positively, to really set a bar in this competition, off the field and on the field. And the Tony Popovic we've watched, played against, admired as a coach.
Well, I haven't, to be fair.
But well, you've admired him. You can say you've admired him.
Yeah. I haven't played against him.
You know, that Tony Popovic is in a position as a coach where he's comfortable to have a Nani in his dressing room. Mm-hmm. This is a personal response to what's happened, because when he was at the Wanderers, all sorts of players were thrown their way. You remember Michael Ballack was a name that was very publicly leveraged next to Tony Popovic at Western Sydney Wanderers. Popper wasn't having it. Now, whatever reason, this is not a Ballack versus Nani. I don't know the personalities. I'm just saying that the evolution of Tony Popovic as a coach with a fantastically strong foundation could mean anything for Melbourne Victory. And let's hope with Nani he can be part of that charge.
Absolutely. Not just Nani as well. But, of course, he's also signed Tommy Juric, who we know is a great talent. If he can get his body right and get him fit for the entire season, then he can provide goals along with Nick D'Agostino and Jake Bremer and others for Victory this season. Just on Nani, we're running a Twitter poll on our 10 football site. How many goals will Nani score this season, do you think? So go to our Twitter site, at 10football, and let us know what you think. Adelaide United's gentlemen, they've been so close to the grand final the last couple of seasons. This is Carl Viet's third full year in charge. I think he's been one game away in both the previous seasons. What do you make of the squad that he's put together? Ben Halloran has returned. They've signed one or two others. Mo Torre and Cassini Yenge have gone. Is there a lot of responsibility, therefore, on Hiroshi Ibasuki? Craig Goodwin stays. That's got to be a bonus. What do you make of the Reds this season, Macca?
Well, I spoke to Carl in the off-season. I said, so who are you bringing in?
Did you get much out of him?
No. And he said he's not getting much money out of the club either. So they've always been a club that rely on their youth system and producing youth players. And when I started coaching 7 years ago and I went to national titles, he was the South Australian youth coach there. So he knows these players coming through. He's worked with them all and he knows how to get the best out of them. And I think he's one of the most underrated coaches in the league. To get so close in 2 years to the grand final with the budget and the squad that he has had, and that's not any denigration to the players that are there, but it's the youth players that come through with a sprinkling of experience. I think he's done an amazing job, and I'm sure we'll see again a couple of players step up, come up to the plate, who break onto the scene and do it again. And they're a team that perennially we always say, oh, they'll you know, make the final, should be a good, but they keep pushing and they keep pushing the envelope. And when you get at home in the end of the season and towards finals, that crowd really gives them that extra lift. And that stadium, I think it's one of the best in Australia to play at as a footballer. I think that really does them a lot of good.
Especially now it's been rebuilt as well.
So that's going to be finished for A-League men's, ready to go for Women's World Cup, and there won't be any disruptions? The whole ground will be open?
I think it's ready, isn't it?
There's a disruption at the start of the season, I think, maybe for a few games at the start. Right. But after that, I think it's back.
Yeah, because you bang on. It's a great venue. You know, we talk about surprises, good and bad, in A-Leagues. What's bankable is Adelaide United being in the finals. completely. And I'd put it on it again now. Like, Carl Viard is a fantastic coach. Yeah. He'll have enough talent to get to the finals. I don't know at this point if he'll have enough talent to win it, because the club's under-resourced. And, you know, we're not talking out of turn. I think everyone knows it. You know, Carl's under no illusions. The owners are very open about the fact that we've got a very finite level of spending. Adelaide have to do incredibly well with the resources that are on offer. That resource is invested in Carl Viard as a fantastic coach, great staff, Richie Aligich overseeing the youth, separate from the club, but still working in really close tandem, wonderful staff, fantastic youngsters coming through because of that system. And so then it gets to Zach Clough. And to me, Ibasuki's proved himself as he can lead a charge. If Zach Clough can find the form of his CV, and if he can find the form that's been told to us by Adam Lafondra, and if he can find the form that we can see for ourselves on YouTube, then, you know, that might be enough of a catalyst to take them even further.
Well, they're saying that he's gone away in the off-season into Dubai and he's been training with Premier League players that he knows, and he's come back fitter than ever and looking leaner and meaner and ready to go. And I think he's one pivotal point, but I don't think there's anyone can argue that Craig Goodwin's a massive part of that team. And he's trying to get over that injury. He's underdone, but says he'll be ready for the first game. But once he gets up and flying, I think he's critical to the success to be on the park.
And I have to say, I'm hugely looking forward to seeing the continued development, we hope, of Nestori Irukunda as well, who is a fabulous talent. Let's move on and talk about the Central Coast Mariners, who, again, maybe surprised a few people last year. Before we get onto their prospects, a word or two, guys, about Matt Simon, who in the last couple of days has announced that he's calling it quits in football, a 15-year career. He's played overseas, played for Australia, won A-League championships, premierships. A few words on Matt Simon.
Well, to be honest, a legend of the game in Australia. Not only of Mariners, but he riled up opposition fans because of his demeanour on the park, which was, I'm going to win, I'm going to drive my team to be winners. He's a winner. Off the park, you wouldn't know it from watching him if you never spoke to him. He's the nicest guy in the world. And he's going to be a part of the club going forward, part of Monty's staff, which is great. He's one of those people that you want around the group. He has experience. He's won everything you can in Australian football now. He's won 7 Golden Boots for the Mariners. So there isn't anyone that you want more around the group to tell them this is the way it should be and keep those standards where they are.
Yeah, he sort of... We've got to thank Laurie McKenna for throwing Matty a bone, getting him off whatever he was doing, scaffolding or plastering or something. You know, it was just, as he said, Matty, it was his holiday trip to Man United that made him think, I want to be a footballer. Now, he's a Mike Cockerell medalist before such a thing was even created. You know, if the East Gosford Rams played in the FA Cup and we're sitting back watching this blonde-haired bullock just knocking people over for fun and for the sake of his team, he'd have been on the shortlist for a Mike Cockerell medal. There's no question. He's had a massive career and his time with football's only finished on the field. Mackie, you're right. He's still going to have a massive influence on the Central Coast, as he should. He's loved by them. And quite rightly so. And all of us. He's been great.
Indeed. Now, the Mariners on field, of course, a few changes. Mark Birigitti's gone, but Danny Vukovic is a more than capable replacement. Garang Kuol will stay with the club until January before he moves over to England to join Newcastle United. They've still got Jason Cummings. There's a few foreigners that look very interesting that they brought in. And, of course, we don't know until we actually see them on the park. Do you fancy that the Mariners will, as a bare minimum, make the finals again?
Well, I don't have any doubt, and that's on the basis of what Nick Montgomery has proven. You know, when he got the job, Stadge left and everyone thought, oh, God, Stadge, you've got the club back to a competitive footing now. You know, it's back where it started. And no one knew much about Monty, apart from the people who employed him, evidently. Not that they always get the things right, but they have with this guy. He's just been, I think, fantastic. I've got enormous faith in his decision-making and his ability to spot talent, bring talent through, integrate talent, make something from very little. The thing about the Mariners, guys, to me, is how they deal with the Garang Kuol situation. Mm-hmm. You know, there's going to be a frenzy around this guy, media-wise. The league's going to want to promote him. Nick Montgomery ain't going to budge. You know, if he's not ready to play, he's not going to play him, despite all the noise about the youngster and despite the nature of the transfer, which is a separate topic. Round ball rules might want to bite off at some point. Why players of that talent are only bringing $300,000 into the coffers. I know there's on-sells, but this is a big topic we should discuss later. My point about the Mariners, I'm expecting a great season. Montgomery, fantastic. Till January, how do they manage the feeding frenzy around Garang Kuol?
Quickly, Maka.
Well, I agree to it a point, but this is what Mariners do. They bring kids through. They do well. They sell them on. They bring another one. Yep. And Monty has helped set up that system, that young development system, so he knows them through and through. And I know for a fact that...
Not with this sort of focus, though.
No. Yeah, you're right. This is another level. But I think, you know, in typical Mariners mentality, we get on with it, we move on, and it's all about the team and the club, and we get going. And I think they'll be up there or thereabouts, pushing for top three. I really do.
Okie dokie. Before we take a break, let's look at the prospects of Wellington Phoenix, who continue to make monkeys out of all of us season upon season. Every year we say, no chance, they're not going to make the finals. And every year, Ufuk Tale goes, yep, we're not having any of that. Yeah. And again, he's lost lots of talent, the likes of Gary Hooper, Josh Sotirio, Gail Sandoval is gone. Look at the squad and think, I don't know, but he always does it, doesn't he?
Every year we say the same thing. We talk about coaches being underrated, and I think there's a couple of them in the league, or a few of them in the league, that don't get the plaudits that they deserve. And for me, Uffy is one of them as well. Absolutely fantastic coach. I love watching him on the sideline. He loves the needling and getting involved in it. Again, beautiful man off the park. But he knows how to get his team. They embed together as a group. They dig in. And last year in particular, it was back against the wall, us against the world. We're away from home, but never complained about it. Yeah. They just went out, did their job. And when they won that ball, they went quick and fast, and they surprised teams. And I don't think anyone expected it. And it'll be interesting to see if it's the similar mentality this year of let's absorb all that pressure and then go. Or are we going to take a more proactive, keep the ball more and dominate games more. So it'll be interesting to see.
Mm. Well, they're playing at home first time in a couple of years. Mm. They've had two home games in 2 years or something. I mean, crazy scenes. So the yellow fever will have a big say on the season. Mm-hmm. Ufuk Tale's writing his own story. You know, I don't know who's underrating him, Macca, but it's no one in this room.
No,
he's been absolute.
Not.
He's a talent, mate. He's the real thing.
Surprised
as a coach.
He's still at Wellington?
Well, No, he's a very loyal guy, and he from what my interactions with Uffy, which go back to his very junior days at Marconi, we were teammates in the 93 grand final, actually. And he was very clear to me, even at that point, that, you know, not only could he play, like, who the hell's this teenager? But, you know, he just had this head on his shoulders. So he's had to fight for everything. He appreciates everything that football has delivered for he and his family, and defends it like a guard dog, right? And the principles that have provided that life for him, he defends it like a guard dog. So it's no surprise to me. Now people are seeing just how good he is. I can't think that there's a coach in the league with a better success rate at recruiting foreigners. The single biggest influence on your A-League team success is how you fill the dressing room with the foreigners. I don't think he's got one wrong, not one. And Davila is probably the high priest of his success. Yeah. He's been fantastic. So now I look at the mid-20-year-old, the Brazilian, Jan Sarsi, and particularly Kraev, the Bulgarian. Mm. He's mid-20s. He's played 30 times for the Bulgarian national team. The guy knows his way around. I did the Macarthur-Wellington Cup match. Very, very impressive player with a fantastic coach and the yellow fever. We shouldn't be not expecting Wellington to make the finals, despite the hemorrhaging of talent.
Bozidar Kraev, remember the name? He could be one to watch out for in this coming Isuzu UTE A-League men's competition. We're going to head off to a quick break, and we will wrap up the other clubs in our season preview on the other side of it. Welcome back to the second half of Round Ball Rules. We're going to continue our preview of the 18th season of the Isuzu Youth A-League Men's Competition in the company of Daniel McBreen and Andy Harper. Guys, we've talked a bit about Macarthur in the show already because of their win in the Australia Cup final. Macca, come to you first. Obviously, Dwight York in his inaugural season as a head coach has already proven that he can win silverware. And we've spoken about his front four, and in particular, Daniel Arzani. Overall, do you think he has the squad balance right? And what has he changed from last season under Ante Milicic, in your opinion?
Well, we spoke about the defensive side of it, and we're talking here, he's talking to Ivan Vujic, a guy that pretty much went off the radar for a few years, was sensational for Newcastle a few years back, and is now starting to see game time and doing well. Now he's brought in Aspro, but this man here, Daniel Arzani, when you're going to talk about this team, we're always, I think 90% of the time, we're going to talk about them going forward. Dwight was obviously an attacking player himself, but he has got attackers in abundance. And when you talk about a front four, it's not just the four. He's got Carter, he's got Noon that hasn't been playing that much in the so he's got probably two players in each position. You've got Kieran Backus now sitting in there to sweep behind those guys as well. And I think, like we said earlier, they'll score more goals they're going to concede. If they can tidy up at the back and just be a little bit frugal in that side of the thing, I think they're going to be really hard to stop.
Harps, you alluded to that in the first half of the show, that the defence was perhaps your concern.
Well, you know, concern's too strong a word. Right. Like they've got a good defensive unit. I don't know about the depth in defence. And it's going to be such an aggressive style of play, which is going to be great to watch. That's a lot is going to ride on Backus, who's a great pickup, but the back four as it's assembled at the moment. But, you know, I look, having watched them, and again, I have to say, they won the Cup. Massive congratulations to them. They're now into the AFC Asian Cup, which is a great thing for the club and for the league to have that sort of exposure. But they haven't been through the weekly test of A-League opponents hammering them, trying to pick a hole in this attacking formation. Where do we exploit some space that's left behind and start putting some real pressure on this back four? So that's my only question mark going into it. But what I will say is I haven't been as excited about an attacking unit since the days of Moy, Nevio and Fornaroli. You remember that? You remember those three? For Melbourne City, it was just spellbinding watching those three connect, and I think we've got something on offer potentially here with Macarthur.
Okay, what about Sydney FC? For so long, of course, the dominant force in the A-League, along with Melbourne City in recent times, had a very disappointing campaign last time around. Steve Corica has changed things around a fair bit. He's brought in the likes of Robert Mack and one or two others. Have you seen enough? And of course, they lost in the Australia Cup to Oakley Cannons. Have you seen enough in pre-season and in terms of Steve Corica's recruitment to suggest that they will be much better this time around, Macca?
I think so. And he's recruited, he's changed up obviously the way they're going to play. They're going to play with wingers, and he's recruited appropriately with that. But also, you talk about those senior players, and I did speak to him before they played the Mariners and said, okay, big Sydney club, you're going to get all these players. He said, no, we want three senior players. And he went and got those three senior players. And then you've got the likes of Yazbek coming in, Segetic, Kajarski, those guys who that Sydney like to bring through as well, who I think will be chomping at the bit to try and push these new guys out. We've got Bratton in midfield who to come back as well. But I think these young guys are going to keep those senior players on their toes and say, well, if you're not doing the business, he knows that I can do it behind. And for me, Segetic was the best player in their Australia Cup games. Looked really dynamic down that left-hand side, created, scored goals. And then all of a sudden, they're bringing in a player to step in front of him. So I think those guys could be, when you talk about the depth of some of the other teams, that depth with the youth who can come on could be the difference between them pushing up that league.
Bratton's return is really important, isn't it, Harps? He's like a new signing, really.
He looked a fantastic player as well, the best passer. Australian passer, Australian-born, bred, developed pass with the football, short, long range in the comp. But how quickly he can get back to full tilt from a knee reconstruction is the question that hangs over every player in such a circumstance. So Stevie Corrick has talked about changing the system. The system was getting stale in the eyes of the players, so hence the recruitment. You listen to the Sydney fans and it's like, OK, we're moving back to an unbelievable new stadium. We've been on the road and doing it tough for 4 years. We didn't make the finals. There's a change of formation. Was now the time for Sydney to go big on a marquee player? This is the question Sydney fans are asking. In the new world of A-League men's football, Sydney fans want that question answered. It puts a lot of pressure on the team that's going out there, not just to win, but to be this marquee team in a brand new stadium with the rebirth of the league, etc., after COVID. So that's a question mark. In 6 weeks' time, give or take, we might be saying, wow, in Robert Mack, they've found the Slovakian Broish. In Robert Mack, they've found the Slovakian Ninkovic. And if that happens, that's going to be great. But that's 6 weeks away, right? I think that puts pressure on the team, on the organisation. Because as some clubs call them Bling FC, they want them to be Bling FC, right? And then in this stadium, which is Bling personified, fantastic new venue, after all this time waiting, let's hope the team can deliver and the fans come and welcome them in droves.
Macca, have Newcastle Jets found the Australian Daniel Pena in Reno Piscopo? Is he the man to fill the creative void in the Jets midfield?
Well, I think he has to be, doesn't he? Whether they play him wide on the left and he comes in inside, or they play him as an out-and-out 10, but he's filling some big boots in Daniel Pena. Touched on him, how he Daniel Peña was fantastic throughout the year, had some dark moments as well, but this guy, I think, is the real deal. Quality on the ball, will look to get on at every opportunity, and it's just how does Arthur Pappas fit him into the way that Arthur likes to play, that gun-ho, go-forward, keep possession style. Yeah. Where does he sit with that? Is it inside? Is it outside? Is he looking to get in behind? But I think he'll be a big player for Newcastle this year.
Angus Thurgate can play that role as well, of course.
Yeah, the further forward, the better for Angus. And with Brandon O'Neill in the team, you know, that will, I'd like to think, release Angus. He's a great attacking player. I don't think he gets the credit really for that part of his game because he's got such great capacity to get up and down the field. He sort of gets... He's the polyfiller. Let's put him here because it's not working at the moment. And I prefer him playing forward, and the challenge for Piscopo, given he's the talk of the town at the moment, is becoming a 90-minute player. I'm not expecting Renault to hit the heights of a Peña. Firstly, he doesn't have the left foot that Daniel Peña's got, so that separates him immediately. I don't expect him to hit those heights particularly, although I think he can get close. But I expect him, and the team needs him to be, a more consistent 90-minute performer. He's got to become this player. You know, fits and starts, that's youth football, and he's well beyond that now. He's got to make that step into senior professional. I'm running the show. I'm the most dangerous player on the field in a jet shirt. You've got to start watching out for me, not just for the first 15, not for the middle 10 of the second half, for the 90 minutes, because I'm going to be causing havoc for the entire game.
Well, Arthur Pappas' team got lots of plaudits last season for good football. This year it's about consistency and results and making the finals. Western Sydney Wanderers, you could say exactly the same thing, Macca. If Wellington Phoenix make monkeys of us out every year, so too it seems on the other side of the ledger, the Western Sydney Wanderers. Surely this is the year. Just put this on repeat for the last 5 or 6 seasons.
Well, where do you go with that? Because that's what we do say every year. Was it 7 years now? 6, 7 years without
2017, the last time
without
they
made finals. Look, nearly my whole page is filled up with how many players have come in and come out of that club. It's up to Mark Roone, and can he put the jigsaw pieces together? Coaches have come and tried before. He needs to work out how he's best going to play, and can all these guys come together? It's just so many players into the club. I think it's going to take time. I'm not sure how many pre-season games they've played. Obviously, they weren't involved in the Australia Cup. They were knocked out in the preliminary qualifications. So what quality pre-season games have they had? But I think this is going to take time. The amount of players that have come in, we might not see the best of them until after the World Cup, until Christmas, when they've really had the amount of time to not only be on the training part together, but that game sense together to really start to work each other out.
Are new signings, Harper. Sorry to interrupt. But there's a lot of good quality Australian players in there, the likes of Oli Bozanic, Lawrence Thomas in goal. Obviously, Miloš Ninković knows the league back to front. Cassini Yenge, a very promising talent up front. So it seems on paper, at least, that there's a very good spine to the team. Mm.
Look, there's a few things to say about the Wanderers. I don't know how much time we've got. But the first thing I'd like to pose to you guys is, when you read that list of ins and outs, the number of Sydney FC players going to the Wanderers, did that catch your eye at all?
Yeah, it did.
Is that an issue for you? Is it an issue for the fans?
Well, I think the Ninković signing is certainly an issue for the fans.
Massive story, standalone story. But the other three
Well,
or four...
Well, Newenhoff and as well as another one I looked at and saw that.
Is that an issue for the
guys.
Fans?
Of
both
so.
Clubs?
Well, why are Sydney players... not good enough to go into that, but they're good enough to go across they must be looking and saying, oh, hang on, what's going on there? Because Newenhoff, for me, a couple of years ago, 18 months ago, he looked like the next rising star to fill that midfield position, then all of a sudden off the radar, and now he's just waltzed across with Ninko to Western Sydney.
Had an injury as well, to be fair.
Yeah, of course.
OK, so what I think about the Wanderers this year, I think they can do it. I was really surprised at the timing of Mark Rudin's contract extension, given where the team sat. We're not privy to... what was on, it just surprised me because they hadn't gone to his plans, I'm sure, I'd say. But what we do know is Rudin's a good coach. He's been given the confidence of Paul Lederer. There's changes behind the scenes as well to rebuild the club, John Paul Demarini being one of those, and I think that's a really smart move personally because the only time since Popovich has been there that the team had a chance of making the finals was when JP came in after Marcus Bubble. That you do the points, that's a matter of historic fact. So somehow he smoked the peace pipe with Paul Lederer and is back in helping build the club. I think that's very positive. and no Australia Cup. And Mark Rudin, I think, has relished it. You know, no one's talking about it. He's not answering questions because he doesn't want to fall into this trap of promising the world and delivering an atlas, and the Wanderers fans are sick of it. So I'm backing him in. I'm backing the recruitment. We don't know anything about them. And I'm going into this season with the Wanderers blissfully ignorant, expecting them to drop a bomb. And I think they can.
Famous last words. You heard it here. We've got it on tape. Andy Harper saying the Wanderers will make the finals.
No, I said drop a bomb.
Oh, right. That could mean anything. Yeah. Brisbane Roar didn't make the finals last year. They struggled for goals, Macca, but this season they've repatriated, if that's the right word, because he's Japanese, Riku Danzaki, who knows the league, of course. And the big signing is Charlie Austin, who's a quality player, we know that. Have they got enough to get up the league and into the finals?
Well, look, last year when they started off, they were creating a number of chances, having more shots on goals than most of their opponents for weeks on end and just couldn't find the back of the net. Now, that's the man there, Charlie Austin. If he can't do it when you're creating the opportunities, then who else is going to do it for you? He's got a wealth of experience at a top level in the UK. He's obviously still got the confidence to be able to antagonise the fans, the opposition fans, but they create chances. They've got rapid players in wide areas who get balls in the box. They've got J.O. Shea who pulls the strings for them week in, week out. If he doesn't get frustrated and comes out of that nine going to look for the game, the ball in games, and stays up as a nine and in the box, I can't see why he can't score goals for this team.
One of the things for Brisbane, I think the biggest thing is not so much what's happening on the field, but the atmosphere at the club. Because in Charlie Austin, in Jay O'Shea, in Scotty Neville, you've got enough quality there. Mili Uznich, you've got Ramaduk Bari, kids coming through for fun. I don't have a problem with that. I think they've got the talent to do it, and Warren Moon's shown that he can steer the talent around on the field to get results. My thing with Brisbane, does the atmosphere around the club, and I'll expand on that briefly, does that determine what the team does on the field? And so often it can. So I'm referring now to the move back into the city, at least for part of the season, to Suncorp. And the sooner that's bedded down as their home ground forever.
Three games out of the season.
Yeah, and they're talking about making it a more permanent move. My opinion is they should be. It's like Paul Keating said, right? If you're not in Sydney, you're camping out. And in Brisbane football terms, if you're not in the centre of Brisbane, you're camping out. Well, Brisbane Roar have been camping out for too long. The fans want to put the tent away. They want to get back on the couch with a roast meal, maybe a cold tinny, and watch their team in town play. Now, the atmosphere around those decisions, how not just the stadium, the Corey Brown thing, very unsavoury. I don't know how that's going to be resolved, but when you're in a dressing room, Macca, you know, players and you're an outsider and maybe being recruited by the club, this noise can get really distracting. Yeah. And the players inside the four walls at Brisbane Roar, yes, we've got a good coach. Does Riku Danzaki revisit his form of a couple of years ago? We're a good thing if they do. If Charlie, yeah. But geez, what about this? What about that? You know, that's the atmosphere I'm talking about. Yeah. Really important for Brisbane Roar that they reposition and start driving the club the way the fans know it needs to be driven. Mm. And that, if they don't do that, that can seep into the dressing room and all bets are off.
Interesting. Last but by no means least, last season's Wooden Spooners, for the first time in their long and proud history, Perth Glory. This is Ruben Zadkovic's first full season as a head coach, Macca. They put plenty of experience around him, the likes of Kenny Lowe and Chris Coyne and Andy Keogh. Mitch Duvray is back at the club as well, which I think is a good thing. There's been a wholesale turnover of players in and out. Difficult to know what to make of Perth this season. What's your take on it?
Look, we want to talk about home ground and all that and what's happening off the field. Well, obviously, they're not going to be in their home ground. Their first away games, first six games, I believe, are away. And then when they do get back home, they're going to be at Macedonia Park, I think. Yep. Now, I look at that two ways. That could galvanise a squad and opposition teams come here and go, oh, we're playing in an NPL ground. This is not what we're used to. And that might make Perth go, well, we can play with this. I think he's done well. I think they've recruited well. They seem to have a relatively good spine of the team, which you spoke about with some of the other teams, with some young guys thrown in. Now, we saw them last year when he took over. He just basically went, right, let's just play all the young kids and see what we've got for next season, okay, and put them in at the deep end, let's be honest. And, you know, he's picked a couple out of there. They've lost a couple that have left out of that group that he would have wanted to keep. But the spine of that team now, I think, looks like it's got experience. When you and then you bring in Ryan Williams, I'm hearing he's doing very well in pre-season there as well. Some great experience overseas. Musti Amini's in there. You've still got Liam Reddy in goals. Zach Duncan's come back. Johnny Katrumbas, David Williams. You start looking at that and going, okay, Aaron McAnuff. You start looking at that and
it's
going, that's not a bad list,
a bad list
of senior players that it's going to lead the way. And they've got a sprinkling of young guys around that. If they can get the team happy and fine within this we're not playing at home mentality, then I think we could see a massive improvement.
They should be used to not playing at home by now after last season.
Yeah, that's a really good point, Simon, actually. But the home ground thing is the key to me. Yeah. No teams, apart from Western United, who've never had a home ground, and they managed to win a comp on the back of being homeless, no other team's dealt with it. It's the fact of the matter. Western Sydney Wanderers, I know it coincided with Popovich's departure, but even predating that, you know, until that CommBank Stadium was built, the Wanderers were wandering and didn't suit them. Sydney FC, for a couple of years, made finals, but it fell to pieces last year by their measure.
Probably Wellington would be the only one.
And COVID enforced. Yeah. So, I don't know, Perth have had a great home ground for a number of years. There's a lot of turmoil around the club because of that and the changeover of players. I think it can fall into place for them. Yeah. You know, Katrumbas, Williams, Musti Amini, these guys, if they're not really hungry, they should be. Mm. And I think with Ruben Zadkovic, they're going to have a coach who, whilst on a very personal level, has recruited these guys into the bosom of Perth Glory. If they're not playing to the hunger that they should, mate, they'll get the size 10 up the Khyber. And all hell could break loose there as well.
Well, yeah.
But I'm backing the qualities of these guys. Mark Beaver's out of England. He's got a lot of experience. League One Player of the Year. Shouldn't be sneezed at, of course. I think they can do it, and it's a big chance for Ruben to prove himself.
OK, well, we're all hungry for football. Last questions, guys. We've got to put the heads on the block here. Champions for you, Macca?
I'm going to go with Macarthur.
OK.
Yeah, I think they've got enough attacking quality there that they'll come through.
The ball's for you, Harps?
Well, I don't know.
Don't sit on the fence, Harps.
Well, I won't if you won't. I think I'm going to back Macarthur to make the grand final.
Okay.
Yeah. Is that enough?
Yeah, that'll do. Okay. Who plays
well,
in
you
the
don't final? Well, you don't win the championship by making the grand final.
I know.
I'll fill in the gap for you. I think they will play Melbourne Victory in the grand final. I'm tipping Victory this year.
Yeah.
I think they came so close last year, and Tony Popovich in charge, I think he's got the right blend this year. But we will see.
Yes.
If you want to read more about the upcoming season, then the 10 Play website has got interviews with all 12 Isuzu UTE A-League men's coaches. Go to 10play.com.au. And don't forget, a massive weekend of football coming up, both on Network 10 and Paramount Plus. Week one of the new season kicks off Friday night. Melbourne City against Western United. That grand final rematch, 7:15 p.m. Eastern from Amy Park. And then on Saturday on 10 Bold, Sydney FC versus Melbourne Victory. The Big Blue, that's Saturday at 7 from the newly rebuilt Sydney Football Stadium, or Allianz Stadium as it is called. We've also got plenty of football coming up on the international scope. Of course, the Men's World Cup not too far away, but we've got Matildas Internationals coming up. Saturday the 8th, Australia against South Africa, the Matildas trying to build, of course, to the Women's World Cup on their home deck next year. And then 4 days later, it is Denmark against the Matildas. Set your alarm clocks, 2:50 a.m. Wednesday morning Eastern on Paramount Plus. And that is us for the opening edition this season of Round Ball Rules. How good is it to have the football back? My thanks to Daniel McBreen and Andy Harper. And enjoy the football this coming season. Bring it on.